Our Creator is crying out for our people to arm themselves for battle. He is crying out for us to bring down the walls of darkness and to loosen the bands of wickedness. We live in an incredible time because soon He is going to send His Son to harvest the first fruits of His family and to deliver a people into a new era of time to begin to mold and fashion the final harvest into His family. But He is commanding for those who will be delivered to return to Him and to cry aloud and to spare not. He has been proving that this is His work recently by what He is revealing in His Word. I have been amazed at all of the prophecies that there are in His Word that point to His people shouting at this time. And there are dual references like Gideon's army and the walls of Jericho coming down that foreshadow the walls of darkness coming down and foreshadow His deliverance. We are only 11 days away from the memento of acclamations that many call the Feast of Trumpets. I spoke about this special day recently in the seventh month, High Days, Part 1, if you want to find out more about it. It's a commanded assembly and a commanded celebration. It was always to be a day of memorial of His deliverances, but it was also to point to this very time that we live in. It makes this coming day very special. This year, this high day will fall on September 30th for Israel and Europe and Canada, but it will fall on the 29th in man's calendar for most of the U.S., South America, and Africa, and Australia, and other places like that. I have spoken on this before. His people are scattered, so until things are restored in Jerusalem, we must be obedient to His calendar from where we are located, our individual locations. This is because He wants us following His instructions and learning them. It is not about a universal day on man's calendar, as many want to make it. It does not matter what day a day falls on in man's calendar in different places around the globe. What matters is that we obey our Creator's instructions. But the dates of Yeshua's return and other important dates are still being given Jerusalem time because this is where He will return to, so this is where the countdown is figured from. Should make perfect sense to any of you. The question is, so what are we to arm ourselves with since He is commanding us to take up arms for the battle at this time? In Matthew 10, verse 34, because do not think that I have come to send peace on earth. I did not come to send peace, but a sword. This is a reality. He did not come the first time to bring peace. Peace will only be accomplished after the seven vials are poured out and evil is purged out. He commanded us to take the truth to the world. The truth was to be a light to the world. He knew that it would not be received, but it was to be a light to the world nevertheless. He goes on in the next verses to say that He knew that the truth would split up families and such, but the truth was to be lived anyway, so that the light of the world would be made manifest so that it could be seen. But it was not, except for by a small flock. It was overwhelmed by the forces of darkness, and Satan's lies have flourished, and the darkness has become the light for most. Now our Creator is sending His wrath to purge out the darkness. The problem for the religions of the world is they think that they are in the light, and they are not. This is especially true of Christianity, who has trampled His Son's blood underfoot, and they will receive a double portion of His wrath for their abominations. The false apostle Saul of Tarsus mixed in truth with lies, and people bought into his lies and chose to believe him instead of their Creator and His Son and His other prophets. This is how the enemy works, and this is why Satan was successful at deceiving the world. If you think that his deceiving the world does not include you, well, this is your choice. And you certainly know better than your Creator, because He told John that the whole world would be deceived, and this would include each of you. It certainly included me. Satan was successful because the world rejected their Creator's protective wings that would have protected them from him. And this was all prophesied to happen, so you shouldn't marvel at this. He accomplished his deception by mixing in truth with lies. Saul spoke that the sword is the word of Elohim, and it is. It is just that he himself perverted the word. Thus he made a different sword, the sword of darkness. Yeshua will return with the true double-edged sword coming out of his mouth. It is the name that he was given, the word of Elohim. I have been sent to bear witness to his word. In preparation for his return, he and his father are restoring his world, his word, to call a people who will return to it. This was prophesied to happen as well. A brand was going to be plucked out of the fire. This brand was going to be given the name Zerubbabel, which means one that has escaped or been delivered from the captivity or flowed out from the captivity. This brand would be given a change of remnant and would begin to rebuild the places that were made waste by the abomination of desolation. He would be the restorer of paths to dwell in. There are so many prophecies about the one who would be made to be this man. These prophecies are being fulfilled right before our eyes, and your Creator is crying out for you to stand with him. A couple of days ago, I read in Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, "Behold, I will send my messenger to prepare the way before me, and Yahweh will seek you and suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom I delight will come to you, says Yahweh of hosts. Who will receive him in the day of his coming, and who shall stand when he appears? Because he is like a refiner's fire and like a fuller's soap. And he will set as a refiner and a purifier of silver, and he will purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer to Yahweh an offering of righteousness. And then the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasant to Yahweh, as in the days of old and as in the former years. The cry to arms that I am bringing forth is the offering of righteousness that our Creator is talking about in these verses. He goes on a few verses later to say that all have stolen from him, referring to tithes and offerings. This proves that this prophecy is not about Yeshua's first coming or John the Baptist's witness to his first coming, because Yeshua testified that they were still tithing even in the smallest detail when he came the first time. Today I know some people who have given way more than 10% in the form of both tithes and offerings. So how come does he say that all have stolen from him? There can only be one way, and that is that all have tithed and offered to the wrong place. They haven't tithed and offered to him. This is because the true place that we were to tithe to, his set-apart people, the Levites, went into extinction. They were scattered, and they lost their identity because of Israel's rebellion, and there has been no place to bring the tithes and offerings because of this rebellion. Therefore, the byproduct of their rebellion has been that all of Israel has stolen from their Creator. All goes back to the rebellion, though. And now he is sending his messenger to restore his tithes and offerings. Don't worry, I spoke the other day that I'm not asking you to send them to me. Sure, I'll be up in arms about that, for sure. But I am telling you that you had better to start offering up to his work, and his work is to shout aloud and to spare not. The date of his son's return has been declared. It was prophesied to be declared. Those of you who want to hold on to the verses that no man knows the day or the hour, you don't believe other verses that Yeshua spoke as well about, that if you're not watching and guarding and repenting, then you will not know the day and the hour. So, and also, I mean, anyway, I spoke about that. He was referring to no man knew back then, and no man was going to know because it was sealed until the time of the end, just like Daniel was told by his Creator. And now the people need to be warned of his coming wrath. I have spoken in other videos about how we are being commanded to break our pitchers, just as Gideon's troops were told to that night, and to let our light shine to the world to bring down the walls of darkness. The problem is we have to have the right oil lighting our torches. All of this is explained in these videos. I'm not going to go into all the detail about what the right oil is and stuff, but our swords need to be our trumpets declaring his word. To have his word is not enough if we are not yielding it to expose the darkness, to cut through the darkness. His word is not the false gospels of Christianity. They are blasphemous to the true word. Yeshua is the truth, and he is the light. But he is also the word, or the logos, of his Father. Truth equals light equals his word equals the Messiah. There is no way to get around this. Scripture spells this out in plain English. Yet man has rejected this plain English and bought into false doctrines of grace. The false messiahs of Christianity are based on a different word, the word of Saul of Tarsus, the abomination that desolated the truth in the hearts of men and women. The sword of Christianity is the sword of darkness. I have been sent to be a swift witness against the darkness. Just as we read a little bit later in Malachi 3 there, a few verses later. In the next video, I will speak of my credentials again that our Creator has given to prove that He has sent me, and I have spoken about them in other videos as well, such as the Proofs and Prophecies video or the Signs from Heaven's Throne video and Follow No Man video and others. But in this video that I'll produce next, it will be more from a viewpoint of what are the odds. At some point in time, we have to be amazed that all these prophecies could be being fulfilled. He has put His word in my mouth, just as He prophesied that He would to the one who would be given the name Zerubbabel. For those of you who think that I am another crackpot or another false prophet, show me where I disagree with His word according to the prophets of old or the eyewitnesses, John and Matthew. You will not be able to. Sure, you might throw some mistranslations of men at me, but look up the words before you send them and then try to hurl them at me. They will splatter in your face because His word testifies to me. And you that are denying that are denying yourselves right into some pretty seriously tough times. You're being commanded to come out of the darkness. He says, come out of her, my people. You're being commanded to return to His ways. If you don't, you will be consumed by His wrath. His ways include joining in with Him and what He's restoring. His ways include making an offering of righteousness to Him. His offering is being restored. I am of the tribe of Levi. Made this clear in the early videos even. One of the first things that He showed me, He says that the people's blood will be on your hands if you don't warn them. How can you warn them if you're pointing them to lies for deliverance? You cannot. If you're not pointing them to the truth, then you are pointing them to the lake of fire. If you're pointing them to a counterfeit truth, then you're pointing them to the lake of fire. If you're not pointing them anywhere, you are still pointing them to the lake of fire. As I said, He has sent me to bear witness to His truth. In the verse that I read earlier about bringing a sword that will divide light from dark, Yeshua went on to say in verse 37, he that loves his father or mother more than me is not worthy or deserving of me, and he that loves his son or daughter more than me is not worthy or deserving of me, and he that does not take up his stake and follow me is not worthy or deserving of me. He that finds his life will lose it, and he that loses his life on account of me will find it. I can guarantee you that if you obey these instructions about losing your life on account of coming to the light, coming to Him, then the dark will hate you. Many in your family will disown you and scorn you and ridicule you. I mentioned in the last video on tithes and offerings how one man has sent the exposure videos of some of the false prophets to their followers. Do you think that he did not receive a backlash from them for doing this? He could even risk his life. He could be killed for doing this. The man in Australia that I spoke of parked his billboard outside of a large church on Sunday. Do you think that he was not scorned and ridiculed, if not just in their evil hearts? Do you think that somebody wasn't possible for somebody to drive by and shoot him or something? So what? It was prophesied that those who bore his righteousness would be persecuted. These men and their families are offering up an offering of righteousness to their Creator. If you think that my bearing witness to the truth is just my opinion of what his truth is, this is because you do not believe my Father's word. The only thing that will be left standing after next July 19th, when the seven vials are poured out on what is left of the world, will be the truth, and those standing for the truth and with the truth. I am standing for the truth. I have been sent to do so. I have been sent to stand for those who will become his children. And you are being commanded to stand with me if you want to become his children. But you will not be forced. It has to be your choice. And you will have to be willing to leave all for his kingdom's sake, just as the first fruits chose to do. I can just assure you that if you are not standing with me, then you are standing against me. You will find this out. There is no middle ground. Yeshua said the same thing. If you're not standing for me or not standing with me, you are standing against me. Yeshua has entered into me just as he has entered into the rest of those who have become the first fruits. or he will when they're resurrected, but he still entered into them, spoke about that before, in spirit and such, meaning the ones that came before he came the first time. But, and just as he wants to enter into each of you as well, and so does his Father. If you say that he has already entered into you and his Father's Torah has no place in you, he has already testified that you are deceived, and he will tell you to depart from him. But you don't believe these verses either. You believe the translations of men that say workers of iniquity, when it's workers of lawlessness. I'm talking about his Father's law, his Torah. And John says that you're a liar and the truth is not in you if you turn your ears from his commandments. Yeshua went on to say in the next verse, in verse 40, he that receives you, speaking of those in the truth, receives me. And he that receives me, and he is the truth, receives him that I have sent. He is pretty straightforward in what he is saying. Verse 41, he that receives a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And he that receives a righteous man in the name of a righteous man will receive a righteous man's reward. What is he saying here? Who is a prophet and who is a righteous man? A prophet is declared by the name of a prophet, and a righteous man is declared by the name of a righteous man. All prophets bear their Creator's name, and they bear his righteousness, not their own righteousness. This is why I said to measure me against his word. If you had measured Saul of Tarsus against his word, you would have known that he was false. But instead you received him, and he came bearing the name of his father the devil. He certainly loved the darkness. He came bearing his own righteousness with his more excellent way. Yeshua goes on in verse 42, and he who will merely give a cup of cold water to drink to one of the least in the name of a disciple, I say to you, surely he will not lose his reward. Is he saying that all that we have to do is give a cup of cold water to one of the least and we will receive our reward? No, he spoke in parables. Look at the context of his teaching in the preceding verses. He was talking about sending his servants out like sheep in the midst of wolves. And then he tells those who will be his disciples to speak in the light and to dust their feet if the people will not hearken to their words. And of course their words were the same words as him, to be the same words, the same logos. And that's what we're to speak of, his logos. We are to speak the truth, which is the light. And we are to testify against the darkness. It's anything that is contrary to the logos. We are to proclaim the truth that will set people free, and not proclaim lies like the world's religions do. Then he tells those who will be his disciples not to fear men who can take away our physical lives and our efforts. He says, but rather only fear our Creator who can take away our eternal lives. Then he tells those who will be his disciples to confess him to men. I have spoken on this word confess before. It is translated from the Greek word homologio, which means to be in agreement with the same logos or the same word. We must speak of him in agreement with the same logos that he was, that he became. We must become his logos, not the make-believe versions of him that Christianity embraces and confesses, the make-believe logos that mixes in the lies of Saul of Tarsus. We must declare him in truth. Then he goes on to tell us that he did not come to send peace, but a sword. That's where I picked up in here today. The sword is the same logos that we are to proclaim. It will divide light from dark, and it will knock down the walls of darkness. It divides the light from the darkness. Some of you might lose your lives in the process. So what? He can resurrect you. You will have to have lost your lives making you will have lost your lives making an offering of righteousness to him, and you will not lose your reward for doing so. So what a better way to lose your life anyhow, if that was to happen. Do not fear man who can only take away your physical life. I know that I will die for what I'm saying. It is written. Who cares? I will live again. And Yeshua talks about loving our lives with our families more than him. And he says that if we do, then we do not deserve what he is offering. He says that we have to lose our lives for his purpose. Is this not what I am asking each of you to do as well? Then he talks about receiving who he has sent, and he makes it specific that we are to receive his father's prophet when he's going to be sent, and that's now. And he tells us that his righteousness and the name that he bears will define him, because he will not come in his own name or in his own righteousness, like all of the false teachers of the world have done, and like Saul of Tarsus has done, and all of his followers. I have not come in my own name or my own righteousness. His word and his righteousness testifies that he has sent me. And this all ties in with those of you who will embrace his righteousness to attain it and serve him as well. Then he gets to this verse about giving the water to drink to the least. If anyone will thirst, let him come to him to drink. This is what we have to bring to the world, the living water. The living water is the truth, which is the light, which is the gate to the kingdom. Yeshua became this gate, and he said to follow him. Folks, this is not rocket science. It is the lies that you have embraced that make it hard to see what I speak. You've embraced the lies, and you have not embraced the truth that will deliver you. The kingdom of Elohim is at hand. You need to repent. Repent and turn from the lies and join in with your Creator in shouting aloud. His Son is going to be returning. His trumpets have begun to sound, and our shouts are to accompany them. Plus, we are to light our torches with his oil and break the pitcher so that the world can see the light. Not cover them under a bushel. If you refuse to hearken to what I am saying today, this will be a witness against you, because I have not come in my own name. I have been sent by Yahweh Elohim to cry out to you, to make straight your paths, and to cry aloud and to spare not. Your rebellion to what he is saying is not going to get you delivered through his coming wrath. This I can assure you. He has set before you life and death. Choose life so that you and your seed may live. There are many who believe that they are in good with their Creator because they pray and they fast and they do good works and they study the Bible. Some even make this claim, I do this all day, every day. There have been a lot of people that have been very deceived. For those of you who feel this way, all faiths have these types of righteous people in their midst. There are self-righteous Christians just as there are self-righteous Muslims and self-righteous Buddhists and self-righteous people in every other religion. If you cannot believe that Satan deceiving the world would include you, then this is just another of the many verses that you deny. If you want to remain in the captivity and continue to not believe your Creator and keep serving your make-believe images of him, he is certainly allowing you to make this choice. But as for me, I will serve Yahweh Elohim. I am just crying out to you to return to him and to serve him with me. When the dust settles, his will be accomplished whether you join in with him or not. It is just that you will not be there to see it. And oh, how marvelous it will be to finally see his will done on earth as it is in the heavens.